Good afternoon. Welcome to Spoken Word 2021 for Clonmel Junction Arts Festival. Thank you for joining us on this live stream. I'm going to have the pleasure of introducing you to the writers and musicians that will entertain you during your lunchtime, so I hope you have something refreshing. We will start after the introductions with the Wood of O, who will sing Motherland, very appropriate to the theme. That will be Will McClellan and Breed Phelan. We will then have Eileen Heneghan with a blessing for Clonmel, her hometown, and for the children. Mawee, Barrett, Drood begins Oscuelga and finishes Osperla with Ismisha Mawee. Patricia Cantwell will raise a smile with How's Your Father and Angelina. Of course, Joe Whelan is as bold as ever, just back in from Raven's Rock with some appropriate cursing in Townie Farmer, a prose piece. Mark Roper takes us on an imaginary curfew-breaking visit to Calm Aga. Margaret O'Brien honours her father's changed identity in The View From Here. Siobhan Ryan brings two tiny, teeny poems that pack a mighty punch, hype and christening. We are joined by Jane Clare, who is the daughter of the daughter of C.J. Boland, and her prose piece links perfectly with our theme, Reflections on Identity and C.J. Boland, 1864 to 1918. We have Marie McMahon, museum curator, to introduce Jane's piece, and I, Eileen Acheson, will read one of my short poems, The Place I Am From. I now hand you over with great delight to the Wood of O to start us off with Motherland. Thank you, Breed and Will.
Thanks, Eileen. Simon.
Where in the hell can you go? Far from the things that you know. Far from the sprawl of concrete that keeps crawling away. About 1,000 miles a day. Take one last look behind. Commit this to memory and mind. Don't miss this wasteland, this terrible place when you leave. Keep your heart off your sleeve. Motherland, cradle me. Close my eyes, lullaby me. Keep me safe, lie with me, stay beside me, don't go. Don't you go. Oh, my five and dime queen, tell me what have you seen? The lust and the avarice, bottomless, cavernous greed. Is that what you see? Motherland, cradle me. Close my eyes, lullaby me to sleep. Keep me safe, lie with me, stay beside me. It's your happiness that I want most of all, and for that I'd do anything at all. Oh, but if you want the best of it, or the most of all, if there's anything I can do at all. Oh, la da da dee, la da dee, la da dee. Now come on, shotgun bride. What makes me envy your life? Faceless, nameless, innocent, blameless and free. Tell me what that's like to be. Motherland, cradle me. Close my eyes, lullaby me to sleep. Keep me safe, lie with me. Stay beside me, don't go. Motherland, cradle me. Close my eyes, lullaby.
A blessing for Clonmel, my childhood home. Blessed be Clonmel, golden honey meadow nestled by Cumra Mountains and Slieve na Mon. May the rising sun light up a new day, gentle breeze blow fresh beginnings, clearing COVID cobwebs, sweeping through streets barely changed over time. O'Connell, Parnell, Gladstone, shops reopen and businesses trade. May the fire of sun warm the benches by the river shore and the hearts of all who sit watching in flow. Herons bring stillness, patience, meditation. May the fire of sun bring growth to Bulmer's apple orchards, future cider and Sidona. I remember Babysham. May the rain fall softly when it comes, bringing growth to all the crops and garden flowers. May it wash away sadness of all who grieve those no longer with us, their bones resting in St. Patrick's and other cemeteries. They live forever in our hearts. May this town welcome those who come from other countries to make a new life. May they know here too can be home. May the ancient memories and mystery held deep in the foundations of the main guard and west gate remind us of our past, all we have survived, and the courage to continue. Blessed be Clonmel. A blessing for the children. Blessed be the children. Laughter carries across the streets from the schoolyard. Hopscotch, skipping, tag. Shouts and roars rise from football field. Small legs run fast, score and save goals. The library has a quiet corner, heads down, imaginations fired up, savouring stories from olden times and new. Kings, queens, dragons and spaceships. Next door, the turquoise water of Clonmel swimming pool fills and empties daily with babies, toddlers, youngsters learning to float, swim, dive. Teens play water polo and practice life-saving. Up the hill, sick children bravely meet challenge. Kind hands and smiles give medication, change dressings and IV lines, reassure anxious parents. On the floor above, new life bursts forth after sometimes a long labour. First cry seldom forgotten. For all the frightened children, may they be protected and find safety. May all Clonmel children be blessed this day and children the world over. May they know the love they are, be kept safe and well, encouraged and celebrated. May their guardians mind their precious care. May the inner child in each adult be reconciled. Blessed be the children.
Thank you. Ismisha Mawee. Ismisha Mawee, Ban Dri, Scriv Noor, Lauer Lani. Woher, Ban Kela, Drefur, Inin, Shan Woher. Colleen Vaughan Aranacht, Heter Ganesak, Gal, Saul, August Man Aista. Tame Osma Viaur, August Nalenta, Shaw, Kuing Maig. Kehe Misha. I am Mawee. I am stone mad, and these days I cover my face with a mask. I am somebody and nobody, a woman of substance and a woman of inconsequence. I've had losses and I've had loves. This town and the mountains that surround it and the rivers that run through it formed me. I love this town and I think it loves me back. The fascia on my face has no intricate carvings, though it could benefit from painting. It is not resistant to sunlight nor UV degradation, for it is speckled with freckles and all of the blemishes acquired in a life. The fascia of my face is a veneer of torment, the place where smiles become guises, a frieze of fury adorned in a false patina. It is, however, tough and durable, resistant to most atmospheric pollutants. The fascia of my face shields rafter with armour, concealing, obscuring, warp-free and unyielding. This Botox for illusionists, at once friend and foe, rarely, if ever, cries, even though it skirts alongside all of the gutters. The fascia of my face has become adept at subterfuge and ruse, a masquerade and a charade of betraying ligament, scoundrel sinew, rogue tendon, rascal muscle, leaden feature, drawn skin, and tired eyes. I am a woman emerging from her cocoon. It has flaked and fallen away. I will unfurl my wings, display my frock and shimmer in the sun, rebellious and free. I have come to know that the boundaries that keep you out are the exact same ones that keep you in. Ismisha Mawee.
Both of my poems are similar in a way. In each of them, there's someone who wishes they were someone else. The first is a poem about mistaken identity. What happens when someone mistakes you for someone else and you long to be the person for whom you were mistaken? And the second poem is a poem of longing and unfulfilled dreams. So the first poem is called, How's Your Father? In an airport queue, mistaking me for someone else, he tapped me on the shoulder. Good God, I haven't seen you in years. And how's your father? I smiled, and somehow, not wanting to disappoint him, I said, he's grand. My father was 10 years dead. It's 2 years since we last met, when Munster played Toulouse. What a day we had. And after, in Casey's pub, he brought the house down when he stood on a chair and sang Spancel Hill. You'd have heard a pin drop. Even the French lads stood and cheered, although we'd beaten them. And you, Oh God, he was so proud of you. His golden girl, he always called you. He kissed me on the cheek. Tell him I was asking for him. I will, I said. At the departure gates, he turned and waved. I almost called him back to be the golden girl again with the father who sang Spancel Hill. And the second poem is called Angelina. She wore her name like a silk glove. Stilettos, scarlet lipstick, and a too tight skirt. French cigarette in an ebony holder. Words like ossified and rapport rolled on her tongue like bonbons. I saw envy in my mother's eyes. Laughed too loud, loved too much. Left her children and went to America. Married twice, buried them both. Came back for a last visit home. I saw envy in her eyes for what my mother had, and longing in my mother for what had never been.
Townie farmer. You're a fucking farmer, Whelan, Billy Bumburger shouted to me across the schoolyard. In 1977, being called a farmer was the biggest insult to any 14-year-old Clonmel townie like myself. I'm no farmer, I said, defending myself as if I'd been caught with a sheep up my jumper. But Billy wasn't completely wrong. I had farmer's blood in me, but I kept it very much to myself. Both my parents came from Harney's Cross, 4 miles up Tickencar Hill at the foot of the Cumras. They came from neighbouring farms, and from around the age of 5, I spent all my weekends and all my school holidays between both farms. Under the watchful eye of my grandfather, I became a part-time shepherd. I'd check for lambs on wet spring mornings, ire burning my calves as Wellingtons and short pants were a bad mix. In the summer, I tended gates at shearings, rattling sheep's poles or standing in gaps to keep yows in. I held lambs for my grandfather while he cut their tails with a bread knife and thought nothing of it when Nanny would use the same knife to cut grinder bread for our tea, giving it just a casual wipe on our housecoat. When my chores were done and the tea drank, I had the whole place to myself. I did most of my work from my maternal grandparents, but I was more drawn to my father's brother, Davy Whelan. Davy kept sheep, horses and cows, and he was the most laid-back man I knew. He smoked rolled-up tobacco and told foul-mouthed jokes. He was rough and gentle in equal measure. I once saw him cut the balls off a stallion and throw them to a grateful sheepdog. He wore a wide-brimmed hat just like a real cowboy. I imagined I was a cowboy. I had the whole Sioux nation of nettles and thistles to fight, and I chopped and slayed for days on end. When I went to bed, having a candle to light the way to my room gave me a whole new adventure. Dark shadows and candle grease dropping on my hand mixed pleasure and fear, and I was the happiest little farmer on the hill. Then one day everything changed. I was 14, and after a long summer stay in the country, I arranged to go back into Clonmel for the weekend. I met my friends Hog and Mucky, and now, while I had been busy fighting thistles and cutting lambs' tails, Hog and Mucky had been chasing girls and cultivating flowers of their own. One such flower was Sheila Noonan. She had dark, shiny hair and red lips that always seemed wet. How could I hope to impress her? I decided to hit her with my best shot. I recanted all of Davy Whelan's foul-mouthed jokes and yarns. She looked shocked at first, but I could tell she enjoyed them, and more importantly, she was listening and looking at me. I was in love. The farm was a world away, but as quick as it began, my weekend was over and I found myself back at Harney's Cross, and suddenly all the things that I had loved about the place now grated. I cursed the backwardness of the place, the lack of electricity, the dimness of flickering candles. I cursed hot wax that stuck to my clothes, and I thought of the lads in Clonmel having fun with all the girls. But mostly I thought of Sheila and the way her head rolled back when she laughed at my crude jokes. I couldn't wait to get back into town, and I wondered how long before I could get in. As it turned out, I didn't have too long to wait. The next day I was helping Davy dose sheep, but my head was back in Clonmel. Davy shouted at me for letting sheep get loose, and I told him to fuck off. I never spoke like that to an adult, and immediately I regretted it. But Davy just laughed. This made everything worse. I dropped the gates I was holding and stormed off before I was seen crying. But when the dust settled, I held tough and demanded to be brought back into town. And the only lift was with Davy. The trip to town was quiet. Davy hardly spoke. So what did this mountainy bachelor know of love, I wondered. I didn't know it then, but it would be years before I'd be back in Harney's Cross. Everything changed after that summer. I hung around with the lads for the rest of the holidays, but the novelty of being back in town soon wore off. I did eventually pluck up the courage to ask Sheila out. I even stole a kiss from those red lips. As the summer ended, so did the romance. I didn't have much to follow up on the dirty jokes, and she found someone else to make her laugh. I managed to keep my farming background quiet for the rest of my time in the tech. The years passed. I left school, fell in love, for real this time. I got married and had a family. Harney's Cross changed a little bit too. Sadly, my grandparents passed away. But Davy, true to his cowboy roots, stayed the same, wide brim hat and all. I used to call to him occasionally. He got older, but he could still tell a great filthy joke. Then one day, in his late 80s, he asked me out of the blue if I'd take over the farm from him. Well, that's where I am now. I'm back up the hill with 200 sheep and 3 dogs. I wear long pants now, so no iron on the back of the legs. And though it probably took me a half a lifetime to realise it, I finally come back home. From time to time, I think of the tech schoolyard and Clonmel and Billy Bumburger's statement all those years. And I think, yeah, Billy, you're right. I am a fucking farmer.
Cwm Aig is one of the more remote cwms in the Comoros. It's a dry cwm, and the name translates as death cwm. Cwm Aig. It's only in imagination I break the curfew and make my way on tiptoe through bog cotton and bog pool to Cwm Aig. Why it's called Cwm Aig, no one seems to know. The cwm is dark and cold, facing north. Cradling no lake, it's void of reflection. Wheat ears dash between boulders, flashing the white arses for which they were named. Cwm Aig, death cwm, what's in a name? Rock is reaching its own slow solution. Can I pick the trickle of water deep under grass? Is rose root in flower high on the cliff face? A peregrine starts to sound its alarm. I mustn't disturb it any further, and I had thought to be so quiet. Perhaps I'll never see the yellow poppy. In some dark corner, its briefness burns. I came here when told I hadn't long to live. The wheat ears I saw then are not the ones I see now. In death cwm, what survives? What survives is spring. Thank you.
I'm going to read a short prose piece, The View From Here, a tribute to the Shure Valley, to Slieve Na Mon, but especially to my dad. The View From Here, for Ned. The mountain of the women is hazy this morning. The lower slopes are visible, but softened by the haze to a white-grey palette. The summit is covered with a cap of cloud. From here this morning, it would be impossible to say how high the mountain goes. In this poor visibility, it would not be advisable to climb. You could easily lose your footing. My father rose every day to go to work in the tannery. Cowhides to be processed, the only sure employment in the town for men. I think of him and who he was. A countryman who lost his footing. The first time when his wife, our mother, died, leaving him with 5 young children to rear. Then he simply got up each morning and did what was essential. He went to work in the mornings. In the evenings, he baked bread. He shopped for the makings of dinners that Josie, his cousin, would come and cook for us while we were at school. He regularly nodded off at the dinner table in the evenings, chin in his hands, then woke up cross because my brothers and I had taken some advantage of his exhausted absence. We, of course, fought over which of us did the clearing off, the washing up, the drying, not wanting to give a sibling an inch. He lost his footing again when the tannery closed, as did the entire town. But he wasn't ever really a townie. The countryside was in his blood. We were all reared by then and gone out into the world. So when the protests were done, he accepted the inevitable and moved on. He sold our terraced house, bought a cottage with a field a few miles outside of town, in the townland of Raithock, beside where he'd been born and reared. He fixed up the cottage, did a lot of the work himself, got himself a collie dog that he trained to obey commands in Irish, and some sheep. He continued to get up every morning to do what had to be done. The view across the valley from Raithock was from a different angle to mine this morning, but wide and beautiful. The mountain of the women remains, ever-changing, yet constant.
Christening Day. In the quiet days after New Year's, you stood on the church steps at the top of the town. Bitter winds whipped round the pillars of St. Mary's, and you held me against you closer still, swaddled between soft layers, the glint of a christening bracelet bearing my name, catching winter light. Hype. Your name should be up there in bright lights, but instead, you fade further into obscurity in a dimly lit bedroom. You are a prisoner of the self-doubt and dark thoughts that keep you awake at night. In a bar downtown, neon bulbs announce a man drowning in his own hype. The crowd go wild and chant his name. Later, he'll sleep soundly in his bed.
In the summer of 1943, the citizens of Clonmel gathered to unveil a plaque on the Gashouse Bridge over the River Shore to honour a fellow citizen, Charles J. Boland. The occasion marked the 25th anniversary of his death in the August of 1918. That same summer of 1943, Charlie Boland and Katie Rhines, youngest child and only daughter Sheila, gave birth to a daughter, her fourth child, and afterthought Jane. 75 years later, she and her brother Brien, sister Mary and Edwina, her niece, representing her brother Paul, were welcomed by the civic and artistic community of Clonmel to further recognise the esteem of their grandfather, which was still held 100 years on. There were dramatic renditions of his work, recitations of his poems, and the plaques were restored to its former glory, the verse from the poem legible once again. He would have been amazed. A modest man, civil servant, eldest of 13 children to Michael Boland and Eliza Quirk. He was born in the barracks as his father was an army man and raised in the workhouse when his father was appointed master. He went to the model school, the Black Rock College, then straight into the evaluation office of the civil service by entrance examination. He wrote as a creative pastime, sending his retrospective pieces to the Clonmel Chronicle on a regular basis. A witty and insightful portrait of Clonmel, of his boyhood experience. The characters, the physical landscape, the body of his work relatively small. However, the authenticity of the man shines through. His affection for Clonmel, its people, bonds him to successive generations of fellow citizens. His ability to reflect and regenerate a sense of identity, a subject of this festival, is the key to his continued popular appeal. Memory is key.
Identity is memory. Without memory, there is no identity. Emotionally, it consists of a constant, shifting repossession of a lost union, a womb of the heart that has the power to liberate the soul. Who am I? From whence have I come? The search for belonging, both the being and the longing, are part of the flow of our sedimentary identities as we move through life. We move forward, looking backward. Mark Twain once famously said there was but one solitary thing that the past was worth remembering, and that was that it was past. However true, my grandfather, C.J. Boland, was a poet raconteur of the past par excellence. From his 20s, he was already recreating the Clonmel of his relatively recent youth, celebrating the people and the landscape of this very particular time and place through the all too familiar lens of involuntary exile. That the exile was within the borders of the island of Ireland did not make it any the less strongly felt. One of his most affecting prose essays, The Moon Over Clonmel, consists of a conversation between two men, writer and station master, as they wait for the mail train to come into the station at Kells Bay, County Kerry. The writer denotes a kinsman by his accent, but does not reveal his old identity until they are about to part. The mood and theme of the piece is loss, and the pathos of the fact that the past can only be retrieved in the imagination. Only those close to the writer would know that the tale is informed by the loss of his firstborn, a baby daughter, Fanny, at the age of 4 months. This essay is to be found in the compilation by James White, My Clonmel Scrapbook, 1907. Charlie Boland was a friend, and the book relies on him as the most prolific contributor of pieces published originally in the Clonmel Chronicle. His trademark was a humorous, anecdotal style, but the ease and felicity of his versification masks a keen intelligence and a depth of erudition that he can call upon, as, for instance, in The Two Travellers, undoubtedly the best known and down the years most recited poem. It is a romp. Like most of his work, it involves a verbal drama, this time between two characters who pit the values of a foreign travel experience against the homespun variety. The amazing array of far-off destinations is matched by the sequence of stations on the branch line to Thurles, alas, now long closed, and followed by a litany of place names, ending with the coup de grace. I wouldn't much care for Sierra Leone if I hadn't seen Killinall,
and the man who was never in Mullinahone shouldn't say he had travelled at all. Although there is now no doubt where his sympathies lie, Charlie Boland's skill, coupled with his affectionate stance, is to treat the two protagonists even-handedly, as he does all the people who inhabit the scenes that most of his prose and poetry bring to life. The streets of Clonmel and the river shore and the slopes of the Cumeras are the stage, and the comedy includes the travellers, then tinkers, who are the actors in a mock heroic poem, The Battle of the Chieftains, hilarious. The inept boatmen who run their vessels aground in the wreck of the Avondale and the wreck of the Gwendolyn, and a real-life cobbler, Jan Lerat, who plied his trade with verbal as well as professional skill at the Old West Gate. In truth, my grandfather's poetry, and prose too, exhibits a love of human character in all its variety and frailty, as much as a love of place. But it is as if they are fused in his imagination. Clonmel and its people are as one, framed in a retrospective vision. A selective vision, but as I said at the beginning, a womb of the heart that brought him sustenance and comfort, and I like to hope and believe liberated his soul. My grandfather's entire published work, although not extensive, is, like the Song of Amargin, the first poet of our Gaelic tribe, a claim to identity. An identity I am privileged to share by descent through his only daughter, Sheila, my mother. I thank my kinsmen and kinswomen of Clonmel for your welcome and invitation to speak at this wonderful festival.
I'd like to share a little poem with you, one of my own, before I introduce you to the writers for the next part of our spoken word. It's called The Place I Am From. I was a star once in the indigo sky, high above the blue, brown, burnt orange and green map of the world. I twinkled as a tiny star far away, cartwheeling with Jupiter, Pluto, Mars. The moon mothered us, we shiny ones, gathered us into constellations. People looked up at the place I am from, pointed out Orion and his chariot, called out, look, it's a bear, a plough. Now I am sprinkled into life on earth. I too look up on a starry night at the place I am from. Next, we will have music from Breigean Will, Gráinneweil and Meadow Song. And then the writing part of the second part is opened for us by Teresa Jones, who's reading from her collection, Servant of Time. She's chosen Around Clonmel and another little poem, Bridget or Pat. Then we have Mary Nugent, possibly one of my favourite redheads, with Redheads of the World and Bloodlines. Breda Joyce, our Galway girl, reads I Am From and Mrs. Atlas, followed by our Kerry poet, Mary O'Gorman, with Mon Briha and Here and There. John Corcoran, back in from kayaking, asks, are you one of them? And his second poem is called Still Time. Bernie Condon, we affectionately call writer in residence in a certain location in Clonmel. Her prose piece will tell you where. Laura Cotter honours her paternal line in Grandmother's Treat. I dare you to not want to peep into her handbag. Mary Clare Heffernan's moving prose piece is based on a true story. We will then hear from our own Jenny Cox with I Am From Strong Hands and Maps, and I have another tiny poem called Town. After that, then, Breigean Will will sing us home with a ballad of Thaigdall, which they'll tell you about, but I believe there's a bard and a muse there. So enjoy the second half, and most importantly, enjoy Breed and Will.
Thanks for that intro, Eileen. The song is called Gráinne, and it's dedicated to all the warrior women out there.
Warrior, sailor, pirate, queen, sailing on the broad back deep, the nurse of all rebellion's sown, protected by her rock-bound shore. Mother, wife, and widow twice, marriage for a maiden's price, rising winds to fill her sails, on and through the frothing waves. This woman who from storm was born, Gráinne ní Wáilge, set sail along the western shore. Gráinne of both land and sea, on Clare Island and Achill's Sound, this woman's deeds, they still abound. Parley with the Virgin Queen, pardon for her plunderous deeds, return to live secure her life, protector of her kinfolk rights. The story of the warrior queen, Gráinne ní Wáilge, no annals scribe will tell her deeds. Gráinne ní Wáilge, this a woman storm was born, Gráinne ní Wáilge. She was master of both land and sea.
Thanks very much to all our audience at home. It is strange being in here in silence, but we're really grateful for the opportunity to play a few songs for you. And thanks a million, Cliona and the Arts Festival, and especially Eileen Acheson for inviting us to take part in this afternoon even. So that song was Gráinne ní Wáilge, and the next song is called Meadow Song. And we released this in May 2020 last year to give ourselves a little boost during the lockdown. And it was received really well, and we really like it. So if you like it too, you can find it on Spotify and all those YouTube and all those places that you can download it. Do yourself a favor and download it. later tonight, I'm really looking forward to hearing the Clonmel Laptop Ensemble, and they'll be here in the Dome at 8:30. So just log on to clonmeljunctionfestival.com and you'll register for your tickets there, and you'll get a link to see the Clonmel Laptop Ensemble, which is the finale of the festival. Well worth tuning in to see that. So
just about there,
any minute now, we're going to have Meadow Song. We've a couple of different tunings for our own songs, so it can take a little bit of time, and try and fill in and not waffle too much.
We're there.
Okay. We were lucky enough when we recorded this originally to have Martin Murray from Carrick and Shore play octave mandolin on this, so you'll hear that on the upcoming EP and on the download. Stirred leaves that have shaken as the thrush calling his love sings out her name. I have walked till my heart has blistered and my hands seasoned with toil, but I'll rest here if you let me, and I'll listen to the wind for my sweet love.
My name is Theresa Jones, and I'm reading two poems from my book, Servant of Time. Around Clonmel. Clonmel, a vale of honey. The grey stone arch of the West Gate rises above to welcome festival visitors. A gate here once stopped Cromwell and his army. The bells of St. Mary's ring out at 6 p.m. across parish lands. Black wrought iron gates of the Quaker cemetery are closed to protect the friends who have passed. Walk Church Road, where bluebells and crocus cover the secret tunnel that led the workhouse poor to end their days in the asylum. On to Marfield, where St. Patrick's Well will soothe your soul with solitude, a balm to our busy lives. Stroll the lake, where ducks and swans will clamour to be the first for the bread, or will nip the knuckle if you're too slow to share. Visit the forgotten places, the hives amongst the purple rhododendrons at Kilnamack. Climb the hill to Bagwell's Folly, overlooking the river shore. Cannon Hill, walk the Munster Way to the Holy Year Cross, and on to Long Mountain, if you dare, past the island homestead, or the ghostly Clonmel village, now just walls and memories, a monument to the past, a green museum, victim of progress. Turning back, head down, inhale the honeysuckle, dream to the blackbird's song, walk the dappled forest paths, throw stones in the Clonmel River. Listen to the running water and let your stress dissolve. Explore Carey's Castle, where children play hide and seek in the tower. Drift away to the mournful call of the buzzards, haunting call of the cuckoo. See how small things really are when you're way above the honeyed veil. And this poem's for my mother. Bridget or Pat, let me naturalise you. What's your name? Bridget, Biddy. We have enough Bridgets here. You can be Pat. Pat became your name until the end. Over 40 years, London wartime years, fear and suspicion. Don't disagree, fit in. Disagreements could lead to isolation. Who are you really? A shrug. Why wouldn't you be a Pat? Take away who you are. Take away your identity, your past, your land. Or move away. Reinvent, begin again. Did you care? Pat in England, Bridget in Ireland. You became who you wished to be. A change of name, insult or opportunity. Who are you really? The answer, whoever you prefer to be, Pat or Bridget. Let it be your choice. For so many, their name may be all they have left.
Bloodlines. Some we tuck in our inner pockets, hold them with affection and pride. Perhaps you knew my Uncle Joe. He used to run a bar down Clonmel side. Some we bury in shadowy places far from the open sky. I think you've confused me with another. I'm not from around here, you lie. Our unspokens were not all darkness. Our stalwarts were not all light. Take care where you take wisdom. There is learning from the night. We all have faulted bloodlines. Why do so many sit in shame? It's nature, luck, and choices. Stand up and own your name. Free that shadowed corner. Let petals emerge in the sun. Yes, my name is Ryan, with a closet of skeletons, just like your one. And this poem, as Eileen said, I dedicated to the redheads of the world with whom I identify. Cursed and unlucky, they feared our mutant blood, burned the vampire from our souls on pyres of flaming wood. They sacrificed our bones. Hide your hair inside your hood. I guess the world always feared what it misunderstood. I stand with you now, auburn mane to palest toe, fiery when the wild is calling, gentle when the world lays low. You choose to hold this burning lady with blood of witches old. We are made unlike the others. We are creatures
of fire and snow.
Hello, my name is Breda Joyce, and the first poem I'm going to read from you is about where I come from in the west of Ireland. I am from Boreens, where bluebells drizzle April ditches and limestone walls shape stubborn fields beneath a western mountain that spills rain. I am from a bucket of napisan stenching in summer heat, from Cosheen bread that begs for butter to melt into crossed quarters. I am from the uncle, the priest, and the aunt, the nun, from where the angelus is said and the rosary is given out. I am from a kitchen where the aga sings and tea is offered before talk. I am from an old communion photograph, second from the left in a lineup of 10. I am from a travelling shop that barters eggs for safety pins. I am from walnut plug and sweet afton tipped, from Omo, Lifebuoy and Tide. I am from the mother of cliches and the father of commands. Get off your backsides and give a hand. Do as you're told, much once more. I am from a west of Ireland town where non-mask goers are blacklisted and curtains twitch as strangers walk the road, where gossip is a choice cut at the butchers, fried in fat that sends sparks of news to be blow-dried at the local salon. Bets are taken on who's been unfaithful. I am from a place where men are fed and women serve, where sex is a census word and blow-ins never belong. I am from a speckled tongue where pishogues stalk white places, where pukas and shawlies invade the dreams of children. I am from blue airmail letters that store words of love and longing, from where after-hours music is a blanket to dampen what's left unspoken. And my second poem is Where I Am Now. It's taken from my just-published collection, Reshaping the Light by Chaffinch Press. And I find myself now in a better place, I suppose, called It's Places No Garden of Eden. I take my banishment willingly, welcome all that is untamed outside these garden walls. I open my arms to bouquets of foxgloves whipped by a northern wind, gather cowslips trampled in a herded field, unchain daisies that cower low in ditches. I bend and hold the fractured china cup that fell from the dresser when the dancing thumped. I admire the stains, the swirling cracks that remain. I welcome the storm at sea that lashes the pier, walk closer to the edge than considered wise. Unhook my anchor and row furiously from the cove. In an unsound harbour, I set up camp, not caring what's in store, and enjoy the sweetest of apples. Shameful no more. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Mary O'Gorman, and our theme today is that of identity. So my identity for 28 years was definitely that of a Kerry woman. And this poem confirms that. You will hear me mention a place name called Lysafuka in this first poem. Lysafuka, I think, is an absolutely beautiful name, but for some unknown reason, it was changed to Beaufort, which I really can't understand. Anyway, that's just an off-the-cuff remark. Monbrecia is the name of a poem. Monbrecia is a wild, bright, attractive plant with reddish-orange flowers, and you would know it if you saw it. This is Monbrecia. I know that on these June days in an old graveyard in Lissafuca, where my mother's people lie, Monbrisha has run wild, has spread its red fingers and long leaves through paths, grass and headstones. Everyone my mother once loved sleeps in a glow of red scent. Sometimes I dream of them. I see my aunts bake, uncles play cards, a young cousin sing on Bunan Bui, the notes rising bell-like through oak trees. And here I am, making the transition to becoming a Tipperary woman, which is my identity now. This is called Here and There. I grew up where cars clattered past, brimming buses spilled tourists into hotels, Jarvis solicited trips in jaunting cars, foreigners jabbered near menu boards, asked in broken English about red deer, the lakes, the way to the eagle's nest. Now I live where leaves linger in the air, trains move through hushed fields, an occasional pheasant flames in the garden. Mist slips down Slievenamon, and the sun sets like glass on its glorious hues of green, blue, pink. Sometimes I dream of trains speeding past, driven by pheasants, crammed with furious eagles, protesting loudly in broken birdsong about wanting to settle on Slievenamon. I wake, not knowing where I am. Thank you.
Called One of Them. You put your name on the application form and that's it. It's who you're known as around this town. Tied to a family name and all of its faults and fortune. Will you get the interview? Maybe. Depends on who you might know or who knows you. Anybody recognize this name? The mail is discreetly sent around. One person's picture becomes a blockbuster movie. Are you the hero or the villain? So you might leave, go away and establish yourself on a blank canvas and through skill and endeavour become a success of sorts, have the life we're all entitled to compete for and make your own name because it's really just you with a title. You will come home one day dripping with success and confidence and why not? But make one mistake and it's the same old chestnut. So what did you expect? He's one of them. And a second poem is called Still Time. I thought I knew you, but I don't. I don't think I do. Do you even know who you really are anymore? Who it is that stands before the mirror, brushing your teeth in the morning? Do you lose the honesty of your nakedness to the clothes you wear every day? Who knows you best? Your friends, your family, me? Or the new acquaintances that think you're such fun, like we used to be? Or are you becoming you? And the you I know is just a struggle, the search. Does the journey in your head have a destination, a bus stop to disembark, an end? Don't change. Just let yourself be, which is what I love about you, what I love about you. And come back while there is still time. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Bernie Condon, and this is my little piece on identity. We all have a certain image of our identity, a belief in what type of person we are, it may well bring comfort and a sense of security, help to make decisions, determine our behaviour. It took many years, after several traumatic events in my life, to recognize who I am now. In the deep crevice of my mind, I knew I had a passion for writing. It came to the fore when I was in my 50s, and so began my journey into the spoken word. I discovered the hidden gems that lie within the walls of my local library. Apart from every book imaginable, it was full of characters who drifted in and out on a daily basis, leaving a story or a poem behind them, and a cloud of inspiration around me. One day in March 2020, COVID-19 arrived at our shores. The doors to my beloved library were closed, the lights turned off, and there it stood, silent and dark for many months. The following day, I started the grieving process for the loss I felt. I also lost my sense of identity, my confidence, and the ability to pick up a pen. All that knowledge, wisdom, history that I held so dear was now locked and hidden away. I wondered, did my little desk miss me? Were the books lonely? Did they too lose confidence and hope? Since that day, back in March, I have regained confidence again. I have regained my identity. With help from supportive groups, my dear family, and my many friends, the doors to my sacred place are once again open. The lights are on. Soon, very soon, I will occupy my seat there again. Thank you.
Grandmother's treat. You at the school gate, my brother's hand held in yours. A stroll round town, a toy from Heaton's. Chips in the caraway at the west gate, on through Irish town towards Connolly Park. Pause for prayer, light a candle in St. Mary's. Mrs. Wren's shop for duck eggs, grinder bread, and all the local news. Back in time for our favourite programme, 40 Coats. You let us stay up to watch The Late Late or Dallas, the illicit theme tunes evoking great excitement. Your bright red lipstick, blotted with a tissue, grey, wavy hair, obediently in place, lacquered in hairspray. Stylish outfits, perfectly colour coordinated. Your handbag, a treasure trove of mints, pens, golf tees, emerald green toffees, red and white sticky clove sweets, rosary beads, a purse full of ready-to-share cash. God-fearing, mass-going, you had your own traumas. Birthing twins at home in the 1940s, the little girl won't make it. But she did. Her twin brother didn't. His name was Sean.
Thanks to John, you know who you are, for his kind permission and endorsement of this story about his wife called Marion. I see her across the street. I stop and call her name, Marion. Her husband John has his arm protectively around her as they walk out of the health food shop in Clonmel. I could have ignored them, but a jealous streak in me wanted her attention. Marion, it's me, I say too loudly, as if she were hard of hearing. She's not. She's in her early 60s, but I could see that our relationship was having the desired effect. She's not pleased to see me. Her happy smile fades to a long, silent glare. John and I exchange a millisecond glance that translated into a crime series. In each episode, he was the hero, I was the villain, his wife Marion, my victim, my conquest between us. Suddenly, she shrugs off John's restraining hand and advances towards me. Each step an accusation, until I was backed up, hands up, pinned against the shop window. You, she hisses at me, you bastard. She spat each syllable in my face. John was visibly shocked at her outburst. His Marion didn't curse like that, but my Marion did. I was ecstatic. Despite everything, she couldn't ignore me. Let's go home, said John. I watched their huddled retreat and whisper, see you again soon, Marion. And my mind drifted to our first meeting. Back then, she was in her prime, weekends camping and beachcombing with John, autumn evening drinks as the sun went down over Nugent's pub in Newcastle. She was vibrant, singing loudly, proudly, Limerick, You're a Lady, with John backing her on the guitar. You're in Tipperary now, Marion, locals heckled good-naturedly, and Mock cringed at her sharp, I'll deal with you later, look. A true cheerleader, decked out in the green and white of Limerick sporting heroes, she never missed a chance to endorse her birthplace. Her unique accent lilted easily, tunefully, in sweet defiance, over the flat brogue of the local Tipperary feckers, as she fondly called them. That's Marion, wife, mother, rugby lover. She was popular, feisty, mischievous, who doted on everyone's children, her own grown and gone. A colourful blow-in. The River Shore is my neighbour now, but the Shannon waters are still in my blood, along with a little Heineken, she laughs. I was just an onlooker then, a benign predator, savouring the fullness of Marion's persona, before I did what I did and flicked the first domino. Our first encounter was on a warm late summer's evening. Marion and John were enjoying the banter in the pub with friends after a hurling match. It was time for me to reveal myself. I was the shadow that blocked her son, the sudden chill making her pause blankly mid-sentence and shiver slightly, causing the ice cubes in her drink to collide and clink. Her mind scrambled for words to fill that silence when two strangers' eyes meet and hold, a connection as delicate and as strong as a cobweb. Who's that stranger, John? She asks a little fearfully. He throws her a haven't a clue look as she stage whispers to his ear, not from Tipperary, I'd say, and definitely not from Limerick. I'm a little hurt, Marion. I'm reasonably well known, actually. A leading player of a group who targets the more mature person, regardless of race, gender, class, creed or status. Sounds good? No? Let me be honest. The truth is, I'm an opportunist. A hitchhiker on the road, waiting for that certain someone to stop and pick me up permanently. You stopped, Marion. Unintentionally, I know. Do you remember after that night in the pub? You picked me up. John wasn't happy, but he fell asleep in the back seat of the car, and we've been together ever since, except I'm the driver now, Marion. John wakes but remains silent as if I'd gagged him. A horrifying realization stills him, his eyes searching for alternatives or wild horses corralled against their will. I think I'll have a cigarette, Marion announces suddenly. Of course, darling, I wink at her. She winks back delightedly. I light one and place it on her compliant pursed lips. John coughs, splutters, lurches forward in disbelief. Marion, what are you doing? You gave up the fags years ago. I'm undoing, she replies saucily, casually flicking ash in no particular direction. I smile proudly. That's my girl. Who are you again, she asks me as we drive aimlessly. You know my name, I scold. Have you forgotten? Maybe I've forgotten to tell you. Funny that. You know the Paul Simon song lyric. I can call you Betty, and Betty, when you call me Al, call me Al. Al, she repeats, and then with sudden clarity, I know you. I don't like you. You're not nice. No, Marion, I'm not. John, are you there? She twists around to him in panic. I want to go home, she shouts, and frantically pulls at the locked car door. Now, now, Marion, relax. I unpause the music, and on comes Limerick, You're a Lady. It calms her. Al who? She asks eventually. John digs his finger into my shoulder and growls like a provoked dog. Don't tell her. Al who? Marion snaps, her hands ringing. Oh, all right, calm the cacks, you two. We've a long journey ahead of us. Silence descends heavily. I take a breath and announce finally, my name is Alzheimer's, identity thief. At your service, Marion. And one by one, the dominoes fall.
Maps for Rosalie and Lillian. Let me show you, daughter, so you can better understand that this soft giving surface is indeed a complex land. See these silver lines mapped across my skin. I expand and contract as I let life out and in. My fingertip print distorted by a tiny line from a careless knife that traveled through a banana skin into mine in one of the best jobs I've ever had, where we danced on tables and drank too much wine. And this one, cut by a surgeon's knife, as a child filled with fear and pain, earned me a certificate of bravery that now sits somewhere mottled in a frame. But how I laughed with my mother till I thought my stitches would burst. The scar comes second, the memory first. Every worry, every care that I've worn on my face, like a heavy stage makeup, has left its trace of the parts I've played in the scenes of my life. A life to be lived in a skin to be worn, to be mapped, to be marked, to be stitched and retorn. I am, for Eileen Kavanagh. I am of strong hands, hands that dressed the gas-burnt flesh of soldiers, that years later held TCP-doused cotton wool to my scuffed knees. Hands that wore a thin gold wartime wedding band, always placed carefully on the windowsill when butter, flour, and sugar were crumbed together and pressed into the most glorious shortbread. Hands that tucked a small cotton handkerchief on hot days into the delicate leather strap of a wristwatch. Hands that held faith in a well-thumbed prayer book, their paper skin as soft as the pages within. Now my sister wears the thin gold band, turning it on her finger as she watches me press crumbs together into a tin to make the most glorious shortbread. We will savour it later as we drink tea from our grandmother's delicate china cups.
town. St. Mary's bells tolled when I slipped from the womb as the river shore flowed past Turn of Abbey. Our playpen was a wooden tea chest from Cooney's shop under the main guard. On Sundays, when farm chores ran late, we dashed to the blue Volkswagen Beetle for late mass in St. Peter and Paul's, bought the paper and a treat from Maxie in the Crescent. On Fridays, the blue car carried home the weekly shopping with the Nationalist, the Tipperary Star, the Bunty, Beano, Judy, with Dennis the Menace, held for us in Carrie's shop on O'Connell Street. In boarding school, girls wearing wine and cream uniforms from Limerick, Cork and Kerry would ask, "Where are you from?" "Killarney, beside the Anner," I tossed back. "From where?" Then I gave them, "Beside the Shure, in Clonmel, County Tipperary, at the foot of Slievenamon." They could place me. Yes, Clonmel, my nearest childhood town, for shopping, late mass and loose tea, in boxes under the main guard. The town where I emerged from my mother's womb into a wider world. The bells of St. Mary's echo closer now in the place I claim as my hometown. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the production team of Clonmel Junction Arts Festival for being so kind and helpful to us, to Breed and Will, who will play us out with a beautiful ballad, to all the writers who took part, to those of you who listened in, and those of you who will send a copy of this performance far and wide. Identity, what's in a name, Clonmel Junction Arts Festival 2021. Thank you, and over to Breed and Will.
Thank you, Eileen.
Thanks, Eileen. The song is called The Ballad of Tig Dowl, and there's a little warning in it for all you poets out there. Don't go crossing any fairy women you meet out in the forest.
Late one even the gloamy cops, I heard the poet say that he spied a lady wandering through, no moon to light her way. Her eyes of green, her skin so pale, and the night was in her hair. And on her back, the willow harp that played a song so fair. The song she sang, she knew of old, she'd heard it once before. It spoke of love, of honeyed plains, and of youth forevermore. To hear it once was all it took to tie the hearts of men to the land on she whose beauty did enslave their every sense. And she sang, sap and a rod of it he made. He cast a circle round himself, reciting ancient words, and by this charm the poet was released from what he'd heard. The Lannon she disturbed in song, she broke a blackthorn rod, and need the shady gloaming night, three times she struck the sod. The minstrel's eyes grew pale and grey as darkness crossed his brow, and the rune she cast plucked out his eyes, and they fell to the ground, and she sang, "Oh, where is my own true love?" Blind minstrel, take your ration rod and find your way back home. When you return, your crops will rot and your wife, she will not know. The face she sees and the voice she hears will be a stranger's song. A fool will cross the land on she, and to no one you'll belong. And she sang, home, ahoo, where is my own true love? Home, ahoo, where is my own true love? Ooh,
the Wood of Oak.